Good afternoon. It's very nice to be here. Talking about the tumors and tumor-like states related to giant cells, we should realize that it's quite an extensive area, and it includes both malignant and benign tumors, and also non-tumors. They often look the same. Here you see a field of small cells, and giant cells are among them. And you see hemorrhages, but nothing special. Looking at this small sample, the physician can make a mistake. So what can it be? It can be something obvious or something unexpected. It can be something very aggressive or not dangerous at all. So the main idea is that pathologists shouldn't take responsibility for making this decision, and we need to work in multidisciplinary teams. We need clinicists and radiologists, otherwise it's just foreseeing. The differential list and the top list, it's giant cell bone tumor that is benign, and it's locally aggressive primary tumor. Here you see the small blue cells, and then multinucleus giant cells. It's non-specific picture. There are no moments and points that could help the pathologist. Who defines this type of tumor as aggressive and rarely metastasizing tumor? About 6% of all cases of bone tumors is a giant cell tumor. Usually 20% of primary benign tumors of bones. So it's mainly related to younger patients, and more frequent among women than among males. And look, as for localization, it's usually in joints, distal epiphysis of femoral bone, and in femoral bone and tibia, as well as radial bone. And if it's in vertebra, it usually concerns the body of the vertebra. As for the substrate, is monocytoid cells. They express ligand rank that when binds with receptors forms osteocluster giant cells, and this is the pathogenesis that defines the tactics. So this is a slide of a giant cell tumor of the patient who was treated with denosumab. You see no monocytoid cells or giant cells, and the tumor was replaced by fibrosis, and you see only fibroblasts. Usually it is one lytic focus, intramedial, eccentric, expansive, with expansive growth, and has a tendency to spread to subchondrial plate. As you see in MRI images, it can locally relapse in 25% of cases, and metastasis usually go to lungs. And after pathological fractures and Sarcoma transformation is possible de novo or after radiation. In rare cases, sarcomatous transformation could happen after treatment with denosumab. So, what are the key diagnostic points? So, usually, this is a patient with long bones, epiphyses, and metaphyses. Usually, we see evenly spread giant cells among monocytoids, and the nucleus of giant cells and monocytoid cells are similar. So we don't G34W cells. We don't have the individual our own. We don't have our own experience, but from the studies we know the action of this element. So, an aneurysmal cyst, it's a benign, a destructive tumor that is made of layers filled with blood. There are multi-nuclei giant cells, here they are, and also osteoids. This is a benign tumor. It's quite rare, only 1% of all cases, usually among young patients, and related to metaphyses in long bones, usually in lower parts of the vertebrae, if it's related to vertebrae tumors. Expansive, eccentric, and osteoid. Looks like a shell of a reactive bone. We can see various cysts, septs with level of liquid. And there is quite a significant problem when it has a solid type. Histologically, it's very difficult to differentiate from giant cell tumors. For aneurysmal bone cysts, so, I'm sorry. Another tumor that I would like to talk about is chondroblastoma. It looks like a benign tumor that damages epiphyses of long bones, and it usually appears in young patients in kneecap.
It often affects proximal epiphyses of shoulder bone. What can help a pathologist not to mix it with other neoplasm rich in giant cells? These are specific to monocytoid cells. They differ in terms that they have a nucleus with longitudinal gyrus and S100 stain, and they have this mesh-like pattern here. They are located intramedullary, maybe eccentrically and centrally, and we can see the disseminated calcification due to this chondroid matrix. We see the radiological image. For chondroblastoma, we expect epiphysis of immature gown lesions. So the logic difference of single nuclear cells, another nosological unit that can imitate any of these conditions is non-ossifying fibroma. This is benign lesion consisting of fibroblasts and osteoclast-like giant cells. Histologically, it's difficult to differentiate from benign fibrous histiocytoma. But there is a specific localization for benign one. This is non-metaphysical part of long bones, but there is no specificity on this picture. We also see small cells that constitute this pattern. There are margins. We can see that foamy macrophages, and there are bleedings and hemosiderin sediments. The majority of non-ossifying fibromas are asymptomatic. They are spontaneous findings, and they can resolve spontaneously, but they often cause pathological fractures in children, usually metaphysis along tubular bones, eccentrically arranged. This lobula will well-defined sclerotic rim, and there can be multiple lesions. Now, we are working according to WHO classification of 2013. In the end of this year, we expect new updated classification, which will contain some changes. In particular, what we used to call giant cell lesion of small bones, we find out that there is a similar USP6 gene mutation, and now it will refer to solid variant of aneurysmal bone cyst. And giant cell lesion of jaws is a new nosological unit, which is called central giant cell lesion. This is a rear tumor-like entity. There are fibrous tissues with hemorrhages. There are multinuclear giant cells and reactive process often takes place in young patients, more often women. It can be associated with hyperparathyroidosis. It can be asymptomatic, and clinical picture doesn't have any specificity. If you see giant multinuclear cells, pink one, here is osteoid, hemorrhage, and small cells, and nothing else. We should mention that brown tumor, it's not a tumor process, but it's a result of hyperparathyroidosis, morphologically similar to central lesions. And if we see multiple lesions, we should remember about hyperparathyroidosis. We see multiple bone lesions, and the most malignant tumor is osteosarcoma rich in giant cells. It's a subtype of osteosarcoma of classical type, characterized by few osteoids, abundance of giant multinuclear osteoclast-like cells. And just imagine the pathologist sees that core bioptate, and if there were no pathological mitosis, polymorphism, hyperchromic nuclear, you may think whatever it could be. but fortunately there is intercellular osteoid, which helps to confirm the diagnosis of osteosarcoma. Radiologically, osteosarcoma often affects metaphysis of long tubular bones. It's always destructive lesion, a soft tissue component is specific, and they can talking about WHO classification, I have to say that many people believe that this book is aimed at pathologists, but it's not the case. It is very useful for any specialist working in oncology. I recommend that you purchase it and read it. We're all waiting for it. Thank you very much for assistance. I would like to thank Irina Turkevich and our colleagues from Radiological Unit, Vladimir Gridasov, Pavel Krzyzewski. Thank you for your attention. Thank you for your presentation. Would you like to ask questions? Thank you. You are a morphologist. My question is to you. Classifications are changing. You, as a morphologist, do you have? So you describe different tumors and benign lesions with regional growth, neurosmal cysts, and so on. But you didn't mention here oncologists as well. Everybody is interested in the degree of risk of morphological form. 30 years ago, there was a table which of tumors, some fibrotic dysplasia, giant cell, and when it can change at certain stage. Do you have any data or the same chart? But from the viewpoint of new classifications, yes, thank you. Did I understand you that you're asking about how often giant cell benign lesion can transform into malignant? Yes, and giant cell tumor lesion as well. Yes, this information is available. Of course, this issue is under study. There is target therapy, which has been developed for giant cell lesions. If they are irradiated, there is statistics that it can dramatically influence ability to malignance of primary benign giant cell lesion. As to specific figures, I'm afraid I couldn't give them now, but I think new WHO classification will have a lot of new statistics and data of genetic studies, and I think we'll be able to find updated information. I think it will be quite soon, in the end of 2019. We, as clinicians and surgeons, come across the situation when there is risk of pathological fracture, minus 50% of bone. It is recommended to operate a patient as a prevention. But there are cases when it could be radiological findings, anatomically irrelevant zone. What shall we do with this lesion? Shall we operate or follow-up marginalization, or there should be some follow-up? So I think we need works in St. Petersburg and other cities devoted to secondary margination of benign lesions, a modern view on this subject. Now, some weeks ago, we were communicating with Professor Peter Nielsen. He has great expertise in oncological tumors in bone tissue. He's saying that surgeons in the institutions talking about giant cell lesions first, and he remembered resection and block. And I think what you're talking about is the idea which is in the focus of everyone's attention. We know that there can be metastasis after several curettages. I'm not competent to contemplate, but I've heard from Peter Nielsen and others that end block resection is a way of treatment, although it is a benign lesion. Thank you.
Next questions. I added some comment on the DINA. Thank you for the citing my book, the table. And then for your question about the grading and stage on the aggressive bone tumor, such as the giant cell tumor, pretty long time ago, our greatest surgeon, Anakin, described that some of the stage on the giant cell tumor. However, basically, histologically, there is no any other criteria to follow in that kind of the grading or staging system in the clinically. In the clinically, and however, in pathologically, only we can say this is a giant cell tumor, not aggressive. It depends on the radiographically, is on the hands as a surgeon you are. And then the other thing is about the so many giant cell lesion we can see in the bone tumors areas. And then the only one thing we have to do that is that this is a giant cell tumor or a giant cell rich other tumors, such as aneurysmal bone cyst, giant cell reparative granuloma, chondroblastoma, all the such as the brown tumors as a giant cells. So we have to differentiate these giant cell tumor or not is very important.
Thank you. Коротко, только, пожалуйста, коротко.
Very briefly. Thank you very much for your presentation. You touched upon an important issue as a multidisciplinary team. Could you tell us how multidisciplinary team are organized, whether pathomorphologist is invited, on which level, laboratory level or the clinic where they discuss that? Thank you. I think Dr. Zinoviev can tell it better as he is an organizer. An ideal and the inspirer. It's for the fourth year that we have this team MDT, and the diagnosis is made in a multidisciplinary team with involvement of radiologists, surgeon, pathomorphologists. Just recently, several months ago, we did that to diagnose soft tissue lesions, so it really does work in our institution. Thank you.